Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fewer, Richer, Greener. Prospects for Humanity in an Age of Abundance by Laurence B. Siegel. Narrated by Steve Menasche. Limit of Liability and Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword. On Capitalism and Humane True Liberalism. Adam Smith, the 18th century founder of economics, and Milton Friedman 2 centuries later, promoted the idea that capitalism improves humanity in a way that cannot be accomplished through any other means. Deirdre McCluskey, the great modern economist, historian, and philosopher, wrote a book that was first called Humane True Liberalism. It is now in print under the more prosaic but still admirable title of Why Liberalism Works. It connects capitalism to the ideals of freedom and human autonomy. Rajendra Sisodia and I have written about conscious capitalism in much the same vein. In this spirit, Larry Siegel, an author trained in finance and economics, but now branching out into demography and environmentalism, has written this optimistic book. Observing that the end of the population explosion is relatively close at hand, Siegel argues that the whole world, and especially the developing world, has been getting richer and will continue to do so, and that the future will be greener as more resources can be devoted to preserving our precious natural heritage. I think he is right. The future will be better than the present, just as the present is better than the past. Apocalypse Now or Apocalypse Not? This is deeply contrarian stuff. People just love to be told the world is coming to an end, and they often believe it. Apocalyptic thinking has been a feature of every religion since recorded history began, and that habit of mind persists even in these irreligious times. As a result, a book arguing, as this one does, that economic and living conditions have been steadily improving for hundreds of years and will continue to do so if we don't foul things up, swims against the current. Optimists sound like they are trying to sell you something, while pessimists sound wise and well-intentioned. But fewer, richer, greener is not a statement of blind optimism. It treats challenges like overpopulation, economic stagnation, and climate change as risks to be managed and problems to be solved, rather than existential threats that we can't do anything about. It proposes solutions that may be uncomfortable, urbanism, nuclear power, and environmental engineering among them, but will work. Panicking and saying we're all going to die will not. Free markets and free minds. Perhaps the most important fact of which Siegel reminds us is that free markets and free minds are the key to solving the most fundamental problem of human life, which is allocating scarce resources to unlimited wants. This is usually called the economic problem. As the great economist Gary Becker showed, however, this challenge extends far beyond ordinary economic considerations to infiltrate almost every aspect of life. Applying economic thinking to a wide variety of problems opens the mind to insights that cannot be obtained in any other way. Here are some questions that are amenable to economic thinking, although they do not appear to be at first blush. Why do some animals, say rabbits, have a lot of offspring and devote few resources to each, while others, say whales, do the opposite? Which kind of animal are we? And is that equilibrium changing? What are the unintended consequences of zoning laws, of gas mileage regulations, of government transfer payments to individuals? Were the Germans who invaded Rome in the 5th century climate refugees? How about the Europeans from whom I'm descended, who invaded the Americas little over a millennium later? These are the kinds of questions Siegel raises in a book that asks the reader to remove the constraints on his or her reasoning that come from a lifetime of mainstream thinking and uninspired education. He asks you to engage instead in the opposite, unconventional thinking, bolstered by quotes from adventurous philosophers, scientists, and humanists through the millennia, and passionate self-education. A Big and Rich Africa? His chapter on education, for example, proposes that we could be on the cusp of a worldwide golden age of education, spurred by access through the internet to books, teachers, and ideas that will reach those previously barred from such knowledge by custom and geography. Siegel quotes Deirdre McCluskey as saying that a big and rich Africa will yield a crop of geniuses unprecedented in world history. In a century or so, the leading scientists and artists in the world will be black. Have you thought about that? You might want to contemplate such an outcome, because it's very likely if what we've observed about genetic diversity on that huge continent is correct. Conscious capitalism. I've written extensively about free markets. While I believe that the single-minded pursuit of profit by businesses is misguided and should be tempered with, or replaced by, concern for all stakeholders, the first lesson that Rajendra Sisodia and I teach in Conscious Capitalism is that capitalism is marvelous, misunderstood, and maligned. From a starting point 200 years ago of more than 90% of the world living in desperate poverty, how did we get to be as rich as we are? We wrote, "In a mere 200 years, business and capitalism have transformed the face of the planet and the complexion of the daily life for the vast majority of people. The extraordinary innovations that have sprung from this system have freed so many of us from much of the mindless drudgery that has long accompanied ordinary existence and enabled us to lead more vibrant and fulfilling lives. Wondrous technologies have shrunk time and distance, weaving us together in a seamless fabric of humankind extending to the remotest corners of the planet." Siegel's narrative fills in the details of this transformation, drawing on modern authors as varied as Mark Ridley, Stuart Brand, Hans Rosling, Johann Norberg, and of course McCloskey, but also a zoo of historical characters, including Charles Dickens, who it turns out appears to have been a capitalist free trader entirely consistent with his Victorian liberalism and compassion for the poor, The Flemish priest Ferdinand Verbist, who developed a self-propelled car in the 1600s as a gift to the Emperor of China, the anonymous builders of the great French cathedrals in the Middle Ages, and the wonderfully named Isambard Kingdom Brunel, England's greatest engineer. Perils and Promise of the Future. But the last 200 years were not a straightforward march from the benighted past into the sunlit meadows of liberal capitalist prosperity. Nor will the future be free of problems. Far from it. In Conscious Capitalism, we cautioned, "So much has been accomplished, yet much remains to be done. The promise of this marvelous system for human cooperation is far from being completely fulfilled. As a result, we are collectively far less prosperous and less fulfilled than we could be." And at this time, we are experiencing a reaction against classical liberal principles in pursuit of the security of borders and trade restrictions. And autocratic rule is in a bit of a revival. These tendencies are almost worldwide and concern me. But in the long term, I do not think they will be more than a blip on the path to greater productivity, exchange, and freedom. Population and the environment. We also face environmental challenges, not just climate change, and demographic patterns to which we are unaccustomed. Among the demographic patterns are low birth rates, not only in the rich world, but in most of the rest of the world, longer and longer lives due to medical technology and better public health practices, and the aging of the population due to both causes. Only in Africa are birth rates anywhere near their traditionally high levels, and they too are falling, although perhaps not fast enough. At any rate, the world's population will peak around 11 billion later in this century, about a 50% increase from the current level. That is, in percentage terms, no more than the increase from 1950 to 1970. And then the population will begin to decline. Thus, we are finally getting our population under control. This is wonderful news for the human race and for the environment. We just have to take advantage of this circumstance and use the opportunity to preserve the natural environment and avoid further degradation of it. Rational optimism. Larry Siegel is, of course, not alone in making his contrarian case, although few of his peers have used art, architecture, poetry, philosophy, and humor as extensively as he has, making this book an exceptionally fun read. The genre that I'd call rational optimism, after Matt Ridley's 2012 book, The Rational Optimist, has been flourishing. In addition to the books that Larry's volume refers to, I recommend the works of Robert Bryce, Byron Reese, and Thomas Sowell. To gather the courage and resources needed to solve the problems of the future, we need to wash away the hopelessness and alarmism that has permeated public discourse and the world of education. These books, in addition to Larry's, will provide the desperately needed restorative. To sum up, don't fear the future. Embrace it with all your heart and mind and work to improve it. John P. Mackey, founder and CEO, Whole Foods Market, Incorporated. Preface. How I came to write this book. A note on language. English does not have a neutral gender embracing both the female and male of the species. In German, it's Mensch, human being, and the word is neuter in meaning, although grammatically masculine, don't ask why. has the best of a bunch of bad choices. When I'm referring to human beings collectively, I often use mankind, the ascent of man, the rights of man, and so forth in this Germanic sense. Humankind, the repetitive use of the human race, which is not a race but a species, and other half-solutions, just don't sound right to my ear, although I use them occasionally. I apologize to those who object. 13 years ago, I read Ben Wattenberg's book, Fewer, his elegy for the population explosion. Showing that the explosion was effectively finished in the developed world, and quickly coming to an end in the rest of the world, Wattenberg wrote in funereal tones, lamenting the end of an age of youth, exuberance, and innovation. I thought it was the best news I had ever heard. And I'm not one of those anti-people people. Some such folks exist. More about that later. For decades, we had heard that the population explosion would impoverish and perhaps kill us all. Now that it's almost finished, it's time to re-examine our outlook. We will have fewer people than we were expecting, we will become richer, and the planet will become greener. This betterment will take place not just in the advanced industrial societies, where self-perpetuating economic growth has been taking place for more than two centuries, but in China, India, and the rest of the developing world. It is the first decent break that three-quarters of the world's population has ever gotten. I don't want it to stop. Yet many people are afraid. We have been told consistently and repeatedly by people who seem to be well-informed that the world is running out of resources, that the economy used to be kinder and more humane, that the costs of advanced technology are greater than the benefits. These concerns, although mostly misplaced, should not be dismissed as the foolish thinking of Luddites who romanticize the past. Change always produces winners and losers, and we need to understand and respect the concerns of people who believe they are likely to suffer rather than benefit from it. Progress is not a military march from debased to elevated ways of living. It is confusing and messy. Life has improved tremendously in the last 250 years. This book argues that it will continue to improve in almost every dimension: health, wealth, longevity, nutrition, literacy, peace, freedom, and so forth. Without overlooking the many obstacles on the path of progress, my aim is to reinforce and help restore people's faith in the future, and help them understand why optimism is amply justified. But this is not a book about population, and I am not a demographer. I've spent my adult life studying the economy, business, and investments, so that is the lens through which I tend to observe human action. As a result, economic progress is my principal focus, although it's tempting, and I've succumbed to the temptation, to write about closely related non-economic topics, such as population and the environment. This book, then, is mostly about richer. More food, better food, less hunger. Longer lives, healthier lives, happier lives. Less work, easier work. Technology that satisfies and makes life more pleasant and interesting. A culture worth enjoying. The amount of betterment that has taken place over the last 250 years, the great enrichment, in what we call the developed world, and which is rapidly spreading to the rest of the world, is almost unbelievable. Humans have lived on Earth for many tens of thousands of years, but only in the last quarter millennium has any large number of them enjoyed the fruits of economic growth and technology on a sustained basis. There were exceptions, Leonardo's Florence and Mozart's Vienna come to mind, but most human lives until the Great Enlightenment were lived under conditions of deprivation that are almost unimaginable today. The phrase Great Enlightenment is from the works of Deirdre McCluskey, from whom you will hear much in this book. She said, "It was a stunning Great Enlightenment, material and cultural, well beyond the classic Industrial Revolution, 1760 through 1860, which merely doubled income per head. Such doubling revolutions as the Industrial had been rare but not unheard of, as in the surge of northern Italian industrialization in the Quattrocento." McCluskey, 2019. Unlike previous doublings, the doubling of income from 1760 to 1860 led to yet another doubling, then another, continuing today and spreading across the world. That is what makes the modern era unique in human history. How we got out of that morass and how the whole world can and will enjoy the fruits of the Great Enlightenment is the real topic of this book. Of course, like anything else, economic output cannot grow forever, if by output we mean piles of stuff. But economic growth can and will mean other things too. Products that are more useful or economical. Services and experiences that did not exist before. Methods of delivery and disposal that improve upon existing practices. That kind of progress can proceed as far as human ingenuity takes it. I am also not a naturalist, but I care about nature. I'd better, since we're an essential part of it. It is possible to imagine a future in which humans appear to prosper at the expense of other living species and the rest of the physical world. This is unacceptable, and in the long run, self-defeating. I am old enough to remember filthy air and water in the United States. Through new and necessary laws, but more importantly through economic growth and improvements in technology, we've largely resolved that problem. The air and water are still filthy in some other places. There are many environmental dragons to slay, and to do that, we need an abundance of fiscal and intellectual resources. Continued economic growth is the key to the solution. It will not be cheap or easy, but we will largely prevail. Fewer, richer, greener. This book is a guide to the past and the likely but not guaranteed future of human betterment. But it is also a reader's guide. In the reader's guide, I briefly describe the 20 or so books that have most directly influenced my thinking on these topics, plus data sources. Luck is the most important factor in life, and I've been blessed with it. I dedicate this book to Connie O'Hara, who, on account of my inexplicable good fortune, became my wife almost 4 decades ago and is sitting right next to me at this moment. Part 1. The Great Betterment. Chapter 1. Right Here, Right Now. Not too long ago, President Barack Obama said, "If you had to choose any time in the course of human history to be alive, you'd choose this one, right here, right now." In a world suffering from war and rumors of war, environmental destruction, poverty, disease, inequity, and every other form of misery known to man, what was he talking about? What is so special, so desirable about this time in history? First of all, we are richer, far richer than any human population that has ever preceded it. Richer not just in money and goods, but in food, health, longevity, education, culture, safety, and just about everything else that people need and crave. Second, we are going to continue to get richer. The present state of human achievement is not a brief, shining moment that will all too quickly pass. We are on the verge of the greatest democratization of wealth and well-being that the world has ever known. How do I know this? We mostly understand the future by studying the past. Since this is not just an economics book, but also a picture book, one that tries to convey its message visually, let's start right away with a picture of income per person in the United States from 1820 to the present, and for the whole world from 1870 to the present, as shown in Figure 1.1. Third, and most importantly, the growth shown for the United States in the top line of Figure 1.1 is finally being experienced by the world at large, including what are historically some of the world's poorest countries. We in the United States are not alone in our prosperity and in the promise of our future. We do not want to be alone. Economic opportunity, cultural achievement, and human betterment are a precious resource to be shared. This book is concerned with the past, present, and future of the whole world. If I appear to be U.S.-centric, it's because much of the available data comes from the United States, and I am an American. The United Kingdom, where careful records have been kept for longer than in the United States, is also an important source of information. But these are just examples. The forces that have enriched these countries can enrich anyone, and will. Looking at Figure 1.1 a little more closely reveals a remarkable fact. In 2016, the average income of all the people in the world was $14,574. Again, in 2011 U.S. dollars, that is, the income that each person earned in 2016 was equal to what $14,574 would have bought in the United States in 2011. This number has been adjusted for purchasing power parity, that is, the differences in the cost of living between various countries. Also, a minor technical point, these numbers are gross domestic product, GDP, per capita, not personal income, though the two concepts are very closely related. How far back do you have to go in history to find a year when the average income in the United States was that low? Take a guess. 1800? 1875? 1920? It was 1949. The United States and its allies had just won World War II. We were enjoying the fruits of our post-war economic boom. And that time in our history is generally remembered fondly. We were the richest country in the world. Yet, the world today is as rich as we in America were then. That is what Barack Obama was talking about. In the Obama quote, I left out, in America. He actually said, right here in America, right now. But I wish he had said, right here in the world, right now. Though the developed world has been rich for a while, the great fact of our time is that the developing world is catching up with us. It's about time. I am being a little cute with the use of Deirdre McCloskey's term, the great fact. She uses it to refer to the fact of massive overall economic development since about 1800. I use it, at least in this instance, to refer to the catch-up of less developed countries to the more developed ones. The Charming Little House. How well did the average American live in 1949 with an income per capita of about $14,500 in today's money? Again, strictly speaking, a GDP per capita of that amount. Households do not get all of it, the government and capital providers receiving the rest. One very visible measure of well-being is housing. Figure 1.2 shows a five-room house that a typical American family might have lived in at that time. I did not select a new house, since most people live in houses that have been around for a while. The house in the drawing was offered for sale 2 decades earlier. Also, everyone shared one bathroom, and all the children would have had to share one bedroom not occupied by the parents. But it was certainly adequate and, to modern tastes, charming. Now, here is what I've called the single most amazing fact in economic history. The average person in the world lives about this well now. To be more precise, the house is one that an American of statistically average income could have bought in 1949 if he or she had access then to what is the statistically average income in the world now. That does not mean that the average person lives in this particular way. Patterns of human settlement have changed. An average, that is to say, moderately comfortable by 1949 American standards, family in a developing country is more likely to live in a high-rise or in a multi-family unit with less green space around it. Today's average householder might also not live in a home that is quite as charming, according to my old-fashioned American biases, or they might love high-rise living. Everybody's different. But they'd have an income consistent with this general level of living, which is the point I'm really trying to make. A Tale of Three Authors. This book will fill in the details of how this remarkable story of human betterment came to be true, what the problems and shortcomings are, and what solutions one might consider. I am emphatic about thinking as an economist does, about the existence of limits, the importance of trade-offs, the power of incentives, and the tyranny of unforeseen consequences. I rely heavily on researchers and authors who have tread this path already. Mark Ridley, who described how prosperity evolves, the late Hans Rosling, who documented the transition, achieved in different countries at various rates and at various times from poor and sick to rich and healthy, and Deirdre McCluskey, who teaches that culture and values are forces even more powerful than pure economic calculation in determining human futures. There are, of course, many other thinkers whom we'll meet along the way. The people who produce ideas worth thinking about are as important as the ideas themselves. The remainder of this chapter introduces the work of Ridley and Rosling. Little pieces of each, since their work is so voluminous. Their ideas are basic to understanding the book's main themes. Their contributions make it clear how betterment, McCluskey's term, has been the grand trend of the last 250 years, emerging at first in northwestern Europe and its overseas offshoots, and then only quite recently spreading to much of the rest of the world. I'll get to McCluskey later in the book, but her insights were as much an inspiration to me writing this book as Ridley's and Rosling's. And I wanted to give early mention to all three because of their influence in setting me along this path. In the subsequent sections, we'll begin to explore the idea of fewer, the fact that the population explosion is ending and why it's happening. Then richer, then greener. Matt Ridley, How Prosperity Evolves. It's a little surprising for an optimistic book on the future of the human race to start by citing the work of Matt Ridley, shown in Figure 1.3, more properly, 5th Viscount Ridley, member of the House of Lords, banker, and owner of land on which coal is mined. But Ridley is also one of the world's finest popular science writers, an explainer of complicated things in simple terms, but not too simple. The variety of his interests is revealed by a few of his book titles: The Origins of Virtue, The Evolution of Everything, and Genome, The Autobiography of a Species in 23 Chapters. For us, the book of Ridley's that is most relevant is The Rational Optimist, How Prosperity Evolves. It's a tour de force that explores how ideas have sex, examples, carriage plus engine equals automobile, telephone plus computer equals internet, creating prosperity out of, well, almost nothing. Although ideas having sex is a headline grabber, Ridley's main point is that prosperity evolves through specialization and trade. This idea is hardly new. It's also the principal theme of Adam Smith's 1776 book, The Wealth of Nations. But Ridley has new ways of explaining old concepts. In the 2 hours since I got out of bed, I have showered in water heated by the North Sea gas, shaved using an American razor running on electricity made from British coal, eaten a slice of bread made from French wheat, spread with New Zealand butter and Spanish marmalade, then brewed a cup of tea using leaves grown in Sri Lanka, dressed myself in clothes of Indian cotton and Australian wool, with shoes of Chinese leather and Malaysian rubber, and read a newspaper made from Finnish wood pulp and Chinese ink. How does this exotic bounty link back to Adam Smith and specialization? Ridley explains. More to the point, I have also consumed minuscule fractions of the productive labor of many dozens of people. They were all, though they did not know it, working for me. In exchange for some fraction of my spending, each supplied me with some fraction of their work. They gave me what I wanted just when I wanted it, as if I were the Roi Soleil, Louis XIV at Versailles in 1700. But I'm not the Roi Soleil, the Sun King, who had 498 servants at his disposal just to prepare meals. How does my life differ from his? While Louis XIV was the richest of the rich, the cornucopia that greets you, a person of average means, as you enter the supermarket, dwarfs anything that Louis ever experienced. Beef, chicken, pork, lamb, fish, prawns, scallops, eggs, potatoes, beans, carrots, cabbage, aubergine, kumquats, celeriac, okra, 7 kinds of lettuce cooked in olive, walnut, sunflower, or peanut oil, and flavored with cilantro, turmeric, basil, or rosemary. It's not just delicious food, of course. Ridley reminds you that although you have no woodcutters to bring you logs for the fire, the operators of gas rigs in Russia are clamoring to bring you clean central heating. You can select from affordable clothes made all over Asia. A light switch will bring you the power of 1,000 candles. In other words, you have far, far more than 498 servants at your immediate beck and call. Of course, unlike the Sun King's servants, these people work for many other people too. But from your perspective, what is the difference? That is the magic that exchange and specialization have wrought for the human species. Okay, you've gotten the flavor of Matt Ridley's way of thinking. Enough for now. You wish your high school history teacher could have explained things like that. But through technology that began with Gutenberg in the 1450s, he can be your history teacher. Now that the internet exists, he can do so without your lifting a finger. Well, maybe one finger. Hans Rosling, Poor and Sick to Rich and Healthy. Whereas Matt Ridley is a consummate armchair intellectual, Hans Rosling, figure 1.4, was a man of action. Too much action for his own good, although he did great good for others. A medical doctor, Rosling died in 2017 of a disease he might have contracted while helping the suffering poor in East Africa. It is not definitely known whether the hepatitis that apparently led to his death from liver failure and pancreatic cancer at age 68 was contracted through his medical work. He was known for startling lectures, distributed as TED Talks, on improvements in health and wealth over time, and his posthumous book, Factfulness, co-authored with Ola Rosling and Anna Rosling Runlund, has become a bestseller. The world in 1800, mostly poor and sick. As visual as Ridley is literary, Rosling tells his story in pictures, which were, when he presented them, movies. Figure 1.5, a composite of two of Rosling's famous bubble diagrams, shows the world in 1800 and 2018 with the area of each country's bubble drawn in proportion to its population and its location on the grid, showing the income, x-axis, and life expectancy, y-axis, in that country. The colors denote geographic areas: Asia, dark gray circles; Europe, light gray circles, and so forth. Magnified versions, so you can see the individual countries and the data, will come a little later. Note that in 1800, all the countries in the world are squeezed into the lower left corner with low incomes and short lives. The impact of using the same scale for 1800 and 2018 is very powerful. Even more powerful when you realize the income, horizontal axis, is logarithmic, doubling with each marker. Few people, if any, dreamed in 1800 that the upper and rightmost reaches of this diagram would be filled with people, actually bubbles representing people, two centuries later. As Rosling exclaimed with great emotion in his TED Talk, "All the countries were sick and poor." In 1800, even the richest countries, the UK and the Netherlands, had life expectancies of about 40. Of course, infant mortality was responsible for much of the low life expectancy, and a great many people lived beyond 40. But the average person's life was pretty miserable, even in the more advanced countries. To illustrate, Nathan Meyer Rothschild, 1777 to 1836, the richest man in the world in the early 1800s, died at 58 of an infection that could have been cured with about a dollar's worth of penicillin, if that substance had been discovered. There were many things that money couldn't buy. Note, Rothschild's fortune, expressed in today's money, has been estimated at $250 billion. About as much as the net worth of Jeff Bezos and Warren Buffett combined as of October 2018. Figure 1.6 shows the world in 1800, the left panel of the previous figure, on a magnified scale, so you can see each country, where it was located in terms of income and life expectancy, and how big its relative population was. The world in 1948. Maximum inequality, the end of the Great Divergence. Skip ahead a century and a half to 1948, which Rosling describes as a great year. World War II had finally come to an end. The economy was booming. A number of countries, such as India and Israel, were newly independent, and Rosling adds, "I was born." But as Figure 1.7 shows, 1948 was also roughly the year of peak inequality in the world. The rich world was already pretty rich. The United States is the large gray circle way off to the right. In terms of income, the poor world, much larger, had either made modest gains or had actually lost ground. Life expectancies had risen everywhere. Astonishingly, China, the largest bubble, was considerably poorer than it had been in 1800, and India, the second largest bubble, was a little poorer than in 1800. Asia was poorer than Africa. This splitting of the world into rich and poor spheres is sometimes called the Great Divergence. The world in 2018. The Great Convergence finally takes hold. After World War II, the Great Divergence began to reverse. At first, the poor countries that started to get ahead quickly were in Southern Europe, then the Asian Tigers and part of Latin America. But the really big change in the world picture came with the opening of China to market reforms in 1978 and of India in 1991 to 1993. Figure 1.8 is the bubble chart as of today, a magnified version of the right panel in Figure 1.6. In Rosling's TED Talk, he practically jumps off the stage as he sees China's bubble rise rapidly in the last quarter century. He exclaims that the poor countries are getting healthier and healthier. His enthusiasm for the modern period contrasts with his view of World War I and the 1918 influenza epidemic. What a catastrophe! Which is revealed as a dramatic, short-lived plunge, not shown here, in length of life. What does Rosling think of the current state of the world? For the first time in history, most people today live in the middle, although some Africans were stuck in civil war and some were hit by HIV. But there are huge differences between the best of countries and the worst of countries. And there are also huge inequalities within countries. Take China. I can split it into provinces. Shanghai has the same wealth and health as Italy, but the rural parts are like Ghana. And yet, despite the enormous disparities today, we have seen 200 years of remarkable progress. That huge historical gap between the West and the rest is now closing. We have become an entirely new converging world. And I see a clear trend into the future. With aid, trade, technology, and peace, it is fully possible that everyone can make it into the healthy, wealthy corner. Note, although Rosling produced many TED Talks, his best-known one, which really should not be missed, is at youtube.com/embed/jbk/srlys_ojo. The quotes are from this talk. Conclusion. We'll revisit these authors as we document in part 3 of this book the improvement over the last 250 years in food, health, wealth, energy, education, technology, safety, and just about every other aspect of life. But first, we'll explore the key reason why we're so optimistic about the future. The population explosion is coming to an end, massively reducing pressure on the environment, the food supply, and our living space. Part 2, Fewer, explores this unique hinge event in the world's history. Part 2, Fewer. Chapter 2, The Population Explosion, Malthus, and the Ghost of Christmas Present. The population explosion is, in the broad sweep of history, just about over. It will almost certainly end in this century, with the world population about 11 times larger than when the Great Enrichment started about 250 years ago. Let's introduce the idea with a picture, which in this case is worth way more than 1,000 words. Figure 2.1 shows the past and projected world population from 1750 to 2100. The annual rate of growth is also shown, represented by the red line. The graphic depicts one of the two central ideas of this book. The other is Figure 1.1 in Chapter 1, showing the great betterment over the last 200 years. Between them, they convey the essence of fewer, richer, greener. The rest is elaboration. Apologies to Hillel. The graph in Figure 2.1 is on an arithmetic scale. If it were on a logarithmic scale, showing equal percentage changes as equal vertical distances, the slowing of population growth would be much more dramatic. But the arithmetic scale has the advantage of giving one person exactly as much visual weight as another, regardless of when he or she lived. So we'll stick with that scale for now. Peak population growth, as a rate, the black line, was around 1970. No wonder the radical pessimists Paul Ehrlich, John Holdren, and the Club of Rome made such terrible forecasts around that time. If current trends had continued, In other words, if people did not respond to changing incentives, but just kept having as many children as they did when life expectancies were short and death rates high, their forecasts might have been right. See theatlantic.com/personal/archive/2008/12/the-insights-of-paul-ehrlich/55882/. It is interesting to note that John Holdren, who said he wanted to de-develop the United States, was appointed senior science advisor to President Barack Obama, although, to be fair, he said it 40 years before he took office. What happened to the population hockey stick? The story told by Figure 2.1 contrasts with the more commonly seen, panic-inducing population hockey stick in Figure 2.2. Both are numerically correct, but focusing on the distant past, when a small group of human beings could barely feed itself, is not particularly helpful in thinking about and planning for the future. Looking again at Figure 2.1, the big slowdown in the population growth rate came around 1990, as emerging markets became more than a marketing slogan, and market economies in less developed countries actually began to emerge. China's period of hypergrowth began with the ascent of Deng Xiaoping to power in 1978. India's began with the 1991 rise of the finance minister, Manmohan Singh. Thus, the two most populous and influential non-Western countries started their march upward from poverty within a generation of each other. They both did so by pursuing variations on market themes. Is it any wonder that their populations began to stabilize around that time, too? Note, the one-child policy in China that prevailed from 1979 to 2015 or 2016 is an exception to the rule that people voluntarily reduce their fertility in response to economic incentives. In that case, the reduction was involuntary. Researchers differ on whether the policy was effective, that is, how many births were prevented, or if it was justified. Falling birth rates, boon or disaster? Ben Wattenberg in Fewer, 2005, was less than enthusiastic about the dramatic fall in birth rates. The United Nations Population Division had just come out with a set of forecasts that were stunning in the speed at which they expected the population explosion to end, and reverse. They later revised the forecasts upward somewhat. Wattenberg meticulously documents the nearly global baby bust, as we'll do in some detail in the next chapter, but comes to the wrong conclusions. I'll focus on a humorous example so that I don't have to summarize his whole dreary book. A February 2004 article in the newspaper The Scotsman says, "The population of Scotland will fall below 5 million by 2009. More worrying is the fact that it's also getting older. All this suggests that by the year 3573, there'll be two people left in Scotland, probably a married couple in their 90s, living in Beardsden. I don't know where Beardsden is, but I know that something strange and unnatural is happening." This isn't going to happen, and it isn't a new concern. In 1934, the British demographer Enid Charles wrote, in almost exactly the same panicked tone, "In place of the Malthusian menace of overpopulation, there is now a real danger of underpopulation." Harvard professor Kenneth Hill says, "Charles blamed the low fertility of the time on what she called the acquisitive society, in which children were regarded as a form of capital expenditure which brings the parent no return commensurate with its investment value to society as a whole. The choice between a Ford and a baby is usually made in favor of the Ford. It's just too tempting to point out that babies are occasionally conceived in Fords. At any rate, the baby bust will self-correct because incentives will change yet again, this time in favor of more children. We will not run out of people. We explore the data and mechanisms of the decline in birth rate in some detail, along with speculations about the future, in chapters 3 and 4. The paragon of animals. As I said in the preface, I thought, upon reading Wattenberg's Fewer a dozen years ago, that it conveyed wonderful news, and I'm not one of those anti-people people. Some writers have referred to the human race as a cancer. Growth for the sake of growth is the ideology of the cancer cell, wrote Edward Abbey. Abbey was a prolific and gifted writer on many topics, including nature and Western living. One of his novels was made into the classic film Lonely Are the Brave. He may have been referring to economic growth, not population growth, but they're related. Sir David Attenborough more explicitly said, "We're a disease. We are a plague on the earth." telegraph.co.uk/news/earth/9815862/humans-r-plague-on-earth-attenborough.html. In 2013, when Attenborough said it, he should have known better. In 1960 or 1970, the comment may have been forgivable, since the population explosion was in full flower. Actually, we cure cancer. Nature gives it to us, and increasingly we make it stop. No metaphor could be less fitting. My view of the human race is better captured by Hamlet. What a piece of work is man! How noble in reason! How infinite in faculties, in form and moving, how express and admirable, the paragon of animals. And when Hamlet says that we are nevertheless only dust, he is talking about his failings, not ours. Although this question is sometimes debated by Shakespeare scholars, it is clear to me that this is the correct interpretation given the immediately preceding line, "I have of late, but wherefore I know not, lost all my mirth, foregone all custom of exercises, and indeed goes so heavily with my disposition that this goodly frame, the earth, seems to me a sterile promontory. This most excellent canopy, the air, look you, this brave o'erhanging firmament, this majestical roof fretted with golden fire, why, it appears no other thing to me but a foul and pestilent congregation of vapors. Source, Bartleby.com, which, incidentally, uses the alternate wording, "What a piece of work is a man," found in some of Shakespeare's folios, but not others. I thought the eventual, not that far off, end of the population explosion was welcome news because the alternative is hard to think about. No physical thing can grow forever at a rate other than zero, so it's just a question of when, not if, the growth will stop. Sooner is almost certainly better than later. There are some Shakespeares and Einsteins who will never be born, but a great many people will live better lives. I do not agree with those who say we are facing an ecological catastrophe, although there's some chance of it, but I concede that the planet is getting crowded. It was getting crowded when the world's population crossed 3 billion around 1960. A lot of the problems we've been facing come from trying to bring to rapidly growing numbers of people the benefits of increasing wealth, more advanced technology, and other aspects of modern life. When some of the pressure from population growth is removed, those problems become much less severe, And it becomes easier to envision, in the only moderately distant future, a whole world as prosperous, healthy, and pleasant as the developed world is now. Malthus's dismal theory. Population grows when birth rates exceed death rates. In-migration and out-migration changes this equation, but let's focus on natural increase, births minus deaths. Under what demographers call Malthusian conditions, named after the English demographer and Anglican preacher Thomas Malthus, 1766 through 1834, population expands to consume all available food and other resources. Thus, any economic progress made by a group is temporary and is wiped out by a subsequent increase in population made possible by the transient surplus. He wrote, "The power of population is so superior to the power of the earth to produce subsistence for man that premature death must in some shape or other visit the human race. Sickly seasons, epidemics, pestilence, and plague advance in terrific array and sweep off their thousands and tens of thousands. Should success be incomplete, gigantic inevitable famine stalks in the rear and with one mighty blow levels the population." Over most of the world's history, it's widely believed that population growth proceeded in a Malthusian fashion, with world population increasing from somewhere between 204 million in the year 1 to a little under a billion in 1750. This was all made possible, the Malthusian theory says, by increases in the amount of food that could be grown, or gathered, or hunted, or fished, and with almost no economic growth per capita. A gifted economic blogger calling himself Pseudorasmus notes that we moderns often misunderstand Malthus's theory. It does not necessarily mean that the average person was living on the edge of starvation. To the contrary, the Neo-Malthusian model implies that anything which lowers the birth rate and increases the death rate will raise the living standards of the average person. This is why different societies with different fertility practices and mortality conditions had very different income levels. At various times, then, certain societies flourished for a while and the average person could live at better than subsistence levels. But until the Great Enrichment began, those periods always ended sooner or later. Then something changed. Malthus's mistake. It is hard to fault Malthus for setting forth a theory that explains so much of what was for him the recent past and even the present. But he had the misfortune to be born at a time when the past was an almost useless forecast of the future. The Industrial Revolution started just as he came into the world, and would be powerfully underway in his native England by the time he left it. Malthusian is now an epithet used to describe a world that is, in the political philosopher Thomas Hobbes' words, solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Malthus did not foresee the world receding behind him. His mistake was to think that there were only two forces at work in restraining population growth. The negative checks, such as famine, disease, and war that Malthus feared, and the positive checks of birth control and celibacy, by which he hoped mankind would avoid the negative ones. He did not envision the third force, economic growth changing the incentives to procreate so that having fewer rather than more children would convey an advantage to the parents. The third force is related to the second. If you decide to have fewer children, you need a mechanism for doing so. But without taking into account changing incentives, it's hard to see why people would voluntarily restrain their reproduction. From Malthus to Modernism. Having taken a stand that is essentially economic, Malthus and his work attracted the attention of the other economists of Malthus's day. Jean-Baptiste Say, a French disciple of Adam Smith, wrote a book in opposition to Malthus. David Ricardo, the British economic giant of his time, became Malthus's friend and failed to see the flaw in Malthus's forecast. But all these men admired Adam Smith, the founder of modern economics. A roughly contemporary historian observed, "If Malthus and Ricardo differed, it was a difference of men who accepted the same first principles. They both professed to interpret Adam Smith as the true prophet and represented different shades of opinion rather than diverging sects." This intellectual kerfuffle among friends is a good segue to the examination of Adam Smith and the Wealth of Nations, the dawning of the Age of Improvement, and the reasons Malthus was so wrong. It turns out Malthus had crossed, if intellectual fights can reach beyond death, no less a master than Charles Dickens. See Figure 2.3. Herein lies a tale well worth telling, but it is a bit of a side trip relative to our main path, which is to the demographic transition and the eventual end of the population explosion and the reasons for it. I hope you will be patient and entertained. The Modern Voice of the Ghost of Christmas Present. The idea that Malthus might be wrong about the future, and that per capita economic growth could be sustained and living conditions improved, had been in the wind for some time when Jean-Baptiste Say published his letters contra Malthus. Rather than getting into the weeds of Say's work, let's look at the Forbes.com columnist Jerry Boyer's extraordinary and influential 2012 article linking the topic to Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. Dickens had Scrooge say, "I help to support the poorhouses I have mentioned. They cost enough, and those who are badly off must go there." "Many can't go there, and many would rather die," Scrooge's visitor replied. "If they would rather die," said Scrooge, "they had better do it and decrease the surplus population." Surplus population, Boyer observes, "That phrase, surplus population, is what first tipped me off to Dickens' philosophical agenda. He was weighing in on one of the central economic debates of his time, the one that raged between Thomas Malthus and one of the disciples of Adam Smith. Malthus famously argued that in a world in which economies grew arithmetically and populations grew geometrically, mass want would be inevitable. Jean-Baptiste Say, Smith's most influential disciple, argued, on the other hand, as had his mentor, that the gains from global population growth, spread over vast expanses of trading, trigger gains from a division of labor which exceed those ever thought possible before the rise of the market order." Guess whose ideas Charles Dickens put into the mouth of his antagonist, Ebenezer Scrooge? And guess who speaks in the voice of Adam Smith? Jean-Baptiste Say and modernity? Boyer writes, "The Ghost of Christmas Present is the key to understanding Dickens' political and economic philosophy. He is the symbol of abundance. He literally and figuratively holds a cornucopia, a horn of plenty. The ghost takes Scrooge to the market and shows him the abundance there, especially the fruits, sometimes literal, of foreign trade." Dickens describes the fruits. "There were great round pot-bellied baskets of chestnuts, shaped like the waistcoats of jolly old gentlemen, lolling at the doors and tumbling out into the street in their apoplectic opulence. There were ruddy brown-faced, broad-girthed Spanish friars. There were pears and apples, bunches of grapes made in the shopkeeper's benevolence to dangle from conspicuous hooks. Piles of filberts, mossy and brown. There were Norfolk biffins, squab and swarthy, setting off the yellow of the oranges and lemons. And, in the great compactness of their juicy persons, urgently entreating and beseeching to be carried home in paper bags and eaten after dinner. A Spanish friar is a kind of onion. A Norfolk biffin is an apple. How else, wonders Boyer, could the poor Cratchits enjoy all this bounty without international trade and enterprise and capital? Surely Christmas Present and his creator, Mr. Dickens, and his teacher, Mr. Sy, are true disciples of Adam Smith, Boyer concludes. Conclusion. And so, the terms of the battle between Malthusians and modernists, sometimes wrongly called cornucopians, were set. The battle still rages today. Neo-Malthusians anticipate lower living standards and possibly ecological catastrophe. Modernists make the case for continued, possibly even accelerating growth in well-being, and regard the environmental challenges as problems to be solved through technology and the wise deployment of economic resources. This tension, and my strong modernist bias, will be a recurring theme in this book. In Chapter 4, Having Fewer Children, People Respond to Incentives, we look at the demographic transition in which birth rates fall in response to, or in anticipation of, improved economic conditions, and document the unprecedented fall in birth rates around the world, including in surprising places we think of as undeveloped. We also, briefly, look at the question of whether this is a good idea. Some people, including Ben Wattenberg, but also notably Julian Simon, whom we'll meet in Chapter 3, thought that policies should deliberately encourage continued population growth. I disagree, and think the best strategy is to adjust to the downsides of a stabilized population. Chapter 3. The Demographic Transition. Running out of and into people. My subtitle is inspired by David Green of Oak Ridge National Laboratory, whose April 4, 2004 presentation at the Institute for Quantitative Research and Finance in Key Largo, Florida, was entitled Running Out of and Into Oil. How do population explosions begin? How do they end? Why do people start having fewer children when they start to get ahead economically? Population dynamics involves a number of mysteries, some of which we'll explore in this chapter. In Chapter 2, we heard from the British demographer Thomas Malthus, who lived about two centuries ago. The environmentalist Ted Nordhaus describes Malthus's view as follows. In response to abundance, humans would respond with more children and more consumption. Like protozoa or fruit flies, we keep breeding and keep consuming until the resources that allow continuing growth are exhausted. Looking backward at history, Malthus was not wrong to arrive at this conclusion. But we are not protozoa or fruit flies. We are intelligent beings that respond to incentives. We can shape our environment. Nordhaus explains. In reality, human fertility and consumption work nothing like this. Affluence and modernization bring falling, not rising, fertility rates. As our material circumstances improve, we have fewer children, not more. The explosion of human population over the past 200 years has not been the result of rising fertility rates, but rather falling mortality rates. As families either consciously or instinctively respond to the lower death rates by lowering the birth rate, the population stabilizes at a new, higher level. and will do so, according to the best forecasts, at a level less than 50% greater than the population we have now. The mechanism by which this operates is called the demographic transition. We'll meet Ted Nordhaus again in Chapter 25, Eco-Modernism. To answer the question posed by the chapter title, no, we are not running out of people. If you're in one of the many places where the population is old and shrinking, it sometimes feels that way. But we have plenty of people. Expanding the economy and the carrying capacity of the Earth to accommodate a still growing and ambitious population should be our main concern, not starting a new population explosion. The demographic transition and population momentum. Once again, a picture, figure 3.1, is the best way to introduce the idea of demographic transition. This transition has taken place, or started to, at different rates, with various starting dates, in different geographic areas. It was first observed in the United Kingdom and the United States. In stage one, birth rates are high and death rates are just as high, so the population does not grow. I believe death rates are exogenous. Nature decides. At least until recently, death rates arose in the natural conditions in which we find ourselves. I'm counting man-made war and violence, which account for a substantial fraction of mortality in primitive societies, as natural causes, because these are the natural outcomes of the struggle for extremely scarce resources. On the other hand, it's best to treat birth rates as endogenous. We decide. Birth rates are the result of conscious human decisions that are made in response to, among other things, death rates. Stage 1. Shoemaker and Morning Star. When Stephen Jay Gould, the evolutionary biologist and dean of popular science writers, toured the Middle Amana Cemetery in Iowa, he was shocked and saddened by a sight we are no longer used to. "Then I came upon the great reminder, so freely available in any town as the ultimate antidote to romantic nostalgia for a simpler past, gravestones of dead children. The longer names do not fit across the small stone. Morgenstern, Morningstar, and Schumacher, Shoemaker." In an aside, Gould reflected on the simple beauty of German names, ranging from humble occupations to celestial bodies, Shoemaker and Morning Star. He continues, "I was looking for more names when I came upon a particularly stark example of the great reminder. The stone read simply, Emil Neckwinder, died 23rd November 1897, one day Olt, O-L-T, a conflation of the German Alt and the English Old, an example of languages and cultures in transition. Emil's twin sister, Emma, lies just beside him. Died 11 Dez, D-E-Z, again the German spelling, 3 weeks Olt." Almost unbelievably, this is not the end of the story. The loss of twins, though tragic, would not mark an unusual event. But directly in front of Emil and Emma's last resting place, I saw that in 1904, Frau Neckwinder bore another set of twins. Again, they both died. Evelyn on May 23rd, 0 week alt, fully in German this time, Eva on September 27th, both pairs of infant twins lie together in death. This private catastrophe did not unfold in an ancient age. It did so in the prosperous United States, in some of the richest farmland in the world in modern times. In 1904, Teddy Roosevelt was president. The Wright brothers had taken their first flight. Daimler and Benz had been crafting horseless carriages for almost two decades. The neckwinders, then, had to produce a great many children if they were going to leave behind any offspring at all. It appears that they did. There were neckwinders in Amana, Iowa until at least 1964. Other descendants may have moved away or changed their names, so it's possible some grandchildren or great-grandchildren are still living. This was the pattern in stage one of the demographic transition. A great many born, few survive to adulthood, but more often than not, the genetic line survives. Sometimes the genetic line doesn't survive. It's easiest to keep track of descendants of famous people, since hobbyists and historians do that for us. Shakespeare had four grandchildren who all died without issue, so there are no direct descendants of the bard today. I could cite many other examples without resorting to people who were themselves childless, such as Mozart and Beethoven. High death rates are the cause of high birth rates. The population, by and large, remains stable at a low level. Stage 2. The population explosion begins. Returning to the demographic transition diagram in Figure 3.1, I hope you didn't mind the long, sad detour, look at Stage 2. Death rates come down quickly as rudimentary public health measures are introduced, beginning in the late 1700s or early 1800s in the most advanced countries. This is largely what made them advanced. Not dying conveys quite a large economic benefit. Some of the same public health measures, basic sanitation, clean water, access to vaccines, are still being introduced in the least developed countries, which are still experiencing their stage 2 population growth. Meanwhile, birth rates come down more slowly. One reason is that for a while, people don't know about the lower death rates or don't believe that the new environment will apply to them. So they keep having as many babies as they can. Other reasons include tradition and religion. During this part of the demographic transition, the population expands very rapidly. Stage 3. Toward a new equilibrium. Later in Stage 3, death rates have fallen about as far as they are going to. This fact becomes widely known. In response, sometimes consciously, but perhaps more often unwittingly, people have begun to reduce their fertility rate dramatically to a much smaller number. They are responding to a new environment, described in Chapter 4, having fewer children, where most children survive. Their labor is not needed for survival on the farm, and raising even a small number of children has become expensive. Yet, despite the much lower birth rate, the population continues to expand due to a phenomenon called population momentum, the seemingly paradoxical tendency of populations to keep growing after fertility rates have come way down. Population momentum is best illustrated by example. My wife's paternal grandparents, the O'Haras, were born around 1880 and had 15 children. They're Irish. Like the neckwinders, they were among the hard-working poor, but conditions in their town were not quite as harsh as in Amana, and 13 of the 15 survived to adulthood and reproductive age. This was something truly new and different, and could not really be foreseen. The family did adjust fairly quickly to the new, healthier environment by reducing its fertility. My wife's father, born in 1927 near the end of a long line of siblings, only had 2 children, as did my wife and I. We all did our part to bring the population explosion to a rapid end. But it did not end quickly. The number of O'Haras continued to grow for the better part of the century. The reasons are twofold. The unexpected survival rate of that first generation of children and their unexpected subsequent longevity. As a result, at least until recently, her father and his many siblings were still alive, as were all the descendants. That's a lot of O'Haras. This population momentum, the persistence of a growing population in the face of low birth rates, begins in stage 3 of the demographic transition and continues beyond that. The effect is most pronounced when the age pyramid, shown in figure 3.2, is broad at the bottom and narrow at the top. There are a lot of young people who will both live longer lives and someday have children, and a few old ones who are going to die. Stage 4. Population stability at a high level. The left panel of figure 3.2 shows the current demographic conditions in Kenya, which is still in stage 2 of the demographic transition, its population growing rapidly. The United States, middle panel, is in stage 4, where birth rates have come down to meet the death rate, and immigration aside, the population has stabilized. Italy, right panel, is in a predicament that isn't even enumerated as one of the stages in the demographic transition. It's a stage 4 situation gone too far, where there aren't enough young people to maintain the population. As a result, Italy's population, not counting immigration, is declining and will continue to for a while. And Italy is not alone in this quandary. If fewer people are a good thing, why is Italy's situation, and that of other negative population growth countries, problematic? First, there will be too few young people to produce the services needed by old folks. We'll explore that problem further in the Low Fertility World section of Chapter 4, Having Fewer Children. But more importantly, fewer in my title is shorthand for fewer people than we thought we were going to have. I don't really want the population to decline, at least not at a rapid rate. To speed the process of betterment and take pressure off the natural environment, I just want the population to stabilize. And it will. A 300-year forecast of world population prepared by the United Nations Population Division in 2004 showed world population shrinking to 3.4 billion people by the year 2300. This is their low estimate. The high estimate is 36.4 billion. These numbers mostly demonstrate that 300-year forecasts are ridiculous. Although the UNPD usually does good work, this is not an example of it. We have no idea what will happen in 300 years. See un.org/en/development/DESA/population/publications/PDF/trends/world-pop2300final.pdf. Stage 5. The fertility of the very rich. As ordinary high-income countries transition to very high-income countries, something we've just begun to see in a few places in the last generation, there's a demographic surprise. Fertility turns up again. I guess it's because children provide some pleasure and a sense of continuity with the future, and the very rich can afford to have more than one or two of them. The demographers Max Roser and Esteban Ortez Ospina write, Miko Merskala, Hans Peter Kohler, and Francisco Bolari found at very high levels of development a fundamental change in the well-established negative relationship between fertility and development as the global population entered the 21st century. We can see the strong negative association between a country's level of development and the fertility level. But at very high levels of development, a Human Development Index, or HDI, over 0.85 or even 0.9, this association is reversed. While causality cannot be established in this relationship, it is evident that, after a given point, Higher development is associated with increasing fertility.
Merskala and others. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.